It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com. Hi, I'm John Malos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. Welcome to the program. It's Wednesday morning. Today we're going to be talking about downtown Fresno and one business owner that got so fed up he moved out. I mean, not only moved out of the area, moved out of town. 436 MeTV Option 11 will also recap last night's convention in the monologue. Back in just a moment. And we're back here on the program on a Wednesday morning, 436 MeTV Option 11. Today's program sponsored by McHenry Protective Services. We are glad that they are the sponsor of today's program, and so thanks for that. Hey, a couple of programming notes. Tomorrow, Peter Nazaridian is going to be in the building, and he'll be talking about several different items you might be interested in. On Friday, it's Doug Vegam. We'll talk about the mayor's race and that scandal. And I call it a scandal that's going out in Northeast Fresno with the water discoloration, the lead, the copper, and all the rest that's been going out there for years, and the city has ignored it. When did the mayor know about it, and what did she know? That's what I want to know. Isn't that what you want to know? And what about the two candidates? When did they know it, and what did they know? Those are the two key questions. And Friday, Doug Vegam will try to straighten out or at least shed some light on what's going on out there at Northeast Fresno and shed some light on the mayor's race. He might even tell us who he will endorse in November. Will it be Henry Perea Sr. or will it be Lee Brand, who represents District 6 out there as a city councilman in Northeast Fresno? All right, before we get started with today's program, time to talk about the Democratic National Convention. Last night, it was night number two. And they made history by nominating Hillary Clinton as the first female ever for a major party candidate for the President of the United States. And so history was made, and also I think Bill Clinton made a little bit of history himself. He endorsed his wife. He probably gave the speech of his life. He talked about how he met Hillary, life together with Hillary, his wife giving birth to their daughter, Chelsea, how she went off to college, went off to Stanford, and how that nearly broke his heart. And then life after Chelsea, of course, in the White House, and after he left the White House, he kind of pretty much put everything in perspective the last 40, 45 years or so. And he described his wife, other than a much personal story that he gave between him and his wife, Hillary Clinton. I think Bill described the differences between his wife and Donald Trump, the Republican nominee. He described his wife as the best game changer that he has ever seen. I'm kind of paraphrasing right now, but he said that she is relentless. She always wants to keep the ball moving forward. Here is a clip of what you heard or may not have heard from the 42nd President of the United States, Bill Clinton.
I married my best friend. I was still in awe after more than 4 years of being around her at how smart and strong and loving and caring she was. And I really hoped that her choosing me and rejecting my advice to pursue her own career was a decision she would never regret. Chelsea was born just before midnight. It was the greatest moment of my life. The miracle of a new beginning. The hole filled for me because my own father died before I was born. And the absolute conviction that my daughter had the best mother in the whole world. So people say, well, we need to change. She's been around a long time. She sure has. And she's sure been worth every single year she's put into making people's lives better. I can tell you this. If you were sitting where I'm sitting, and you heard what I have heard at every dinner conversation, every lunch conversation, on every long walk, you would say, this woman has never been satisfied with the status quo in anything. She always wants to move the ball forward. That is just who she is.
All right, the 42nd president of the United States describing in detail from start to finish a very emotional speech by Bill Clinton, maybe the best ever, describing his life with Hillary Rodham Clinton, the first woman to be nominated in a major party for the presidency of the United States. She is going to speak at the convention on Thursday night. But tonight on tap, you've got President Obama, Vice President Joseph Biden, and the vice president nominee, Tim Kaine, all three major speakers tonight in night number three, Democratic National Convention taking place in Philadelphia. We'll have a little bit of a wrap for you by this time tomorrow in case you missed all the festivities last night. And by the way, Bernie Sanders so far has received the biggest ovation out of anyone in that convention hall. 3 to 4 minutes standing ovation before he even got started on Monday night. Bill Clinton did not even come close to that. We'll see what Hillary does on Thursday night. We'll get to the topic of the day right now, and that is that some people believe that those negative perceptions of downtown Fresno continue to linger even after all these years, and even after the Assemi housing projects have been built in downtown Fresno, the downtown baseball stadium, you've got Bitwise Company, you've got new retail, and you have the rebuilding of the Fulton Mall. There remains this perception, though, that there was a lot of crime in downtown Fresno, that it's not safe, there isn't parking, and aside from going to a baseball game, the Fresno Grizzlies, there really isn't much to do in downtown Fresno once everything shuts down at 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. I want you to roll the videotape, my friends. I'll show you what today's show is all about and why we're talking about it. For one bike shop owner, Darren Johnson, he'd had enough of downtown Fresno and all the crime that goes with it. He packed up and he moved out. You're looking at Johnson's new bike shop in the city of Hanford. That's right, Hanford. That's where he picked up and moved to. Johnson's old bike shop was located on the Fulton Street near the Warner's Theater. And in May, the final straw came after a woman broke in, took two bikes, and took off. The burglar apparently smashed windows, grabbed a bike, and later tossed it in a dumpster after finding out it had no pedals. She went back to Johnson's bike shop, by the way, and snatched another bike. That was later recovered, but that incident was preceded by a trio of smash-and-grab burglaries earlier this year. And at the time, Johnson vowed to stay in downtown Fresno and planned to use old bike parts as bars on the windows, but the woman smashed and grabbed before Johnson could get those bars installed. Is burglary a major problem in downtown Fresno? Well, according to the Fresno Police Department, crime is up in southwest Fresno, which includes part of downtown. Burglary was up by as much as 13% or more in southwest Fresno. Not good news for those supporters of downtown like the mayor or the Bitwise guy. Many members of the Fresno City Council probably don't like to hear this as well, or anyone who is touting the downtown area. Live in our studio right now is Darren Johnson, the owner of Fulton Cycle Works, now located in the city of Hanford. It'll be interesting, my friends, to see if he keeps the same name. I don't know. He's got the truck outside. It has the same name, but he's located in Hanford. Why did he get out? Too much crime, broken into too many times into his bike shop. He'd had it up to here. He says, I'm out. And you know what? He had the guts to get out and the guts to move. Does he regret it? 436-ME-TV, option 11. And will this be an issue in the upcoming campaign, the run for mayor? We'll be back after this from McHenry Protective Services, waiting anxiously for your phone calls today on this one. Back in a moment.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
Frigidaire. It means the first refrigerator. It means a history of innovations that help make your home life better. And now we introduce the new Frigidaire French door refrigerator with over 100 ways to organize for maximum flexibility. Built with adjustable flip-up and slide-under shelving and stackable crisper drawers, it's the refrigerator that flexes to fit it all, no matter what your day will bring. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation.
See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on ENERGY STAR qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
So back here on the program, talking about downtown Fresno once again, and it always seems to come up no matter what goes on down there. You've got Darius Assemi building all those housing projects down there. He's already built them. Low-income housing for a lot of people, a lot of single people living down there. Doesn't matter. Downtown perception hasn't changed. Even Assemi himself probably readily admits that. Downtown baseball stadium has made no difference the last 13, 14 years. Bit-wise, it really hasn't made a difference. You know, the bottom line is, downtown has had this perception for a long time. It's unsafe, there's no place to park, and there's nothing to do after hours. What is there to do in downtown Fresno? You've got vagrancy, you've got people walking around, maybe dealing drugs, maybe using drugs, and so the perception is, I'm not taking my family down there. It has been that way for a long time, and the people up north that live north of, say, Shaw, maybe north of Bullard, maybe north of Herndon, they don't want to make the trek down there. They don't want to take their families down there. Darren Johnson is the owner of Fulton Cycle Works. Darren, welcome to the program. I'm glad you are here. And so you decided you've had enough after that last break-in in May, and you had the guts to pull out. That took a lot of, I guess, thinking before the move?
A lot of thinking. And definitely wasn't a decision that came easily, but we had been looking at moving to Hanford as a second location, not as our only location, for a couple of years, as an expansion. And after that last break-in, I had, as far as I could tell, I had two choices. One was close completely, or the other was move out of town. And we decided to just put all of our eggs in one basket and move.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So why did you make that decision?
Well, a lot of it was due to limited resources. We only had so much money. Another was due to my sanity, you know, staying up at night waiting for the phone call from the alarm company.
How many times did that happen? How many times did you get that call at night?
We were broken into five times.
Five times in a span of how long?
Well, that was in the course of the 3 years that we were open downtown. One came right after we opened. And the other one came, or the other four came this spring, starting in February, ending in May.
Wow. So five times in a span of, say, a year or so, or 3 years?
Five times in 3 years, four times in 2 months.
You got to be kidding me. And so did you, hang on, Calder, did you alert, who's your city councilman, or who was?
Actually, I'm not even sure in that district who it is.
So you never bothered to contact City Hall? You never bothered to complain to the mayor's office? You didn't say, hey, look, I'm a business owner. You guys are touting downtown. Look what's going on here. I've been broken into four times in the last several months here.
Well, after the third one this spring, the mayor's office called me, and the mayor herself called me.
She called you?
She called me.
You are kidding me. Hang on, caller. I got to hear this story. So tell in detail. We have a lot of time today. So in detail, what did she say?
Mainly, she was just telling me to keep my head up and asking if there's anything that they could do. Of course, what they could do and, you know, what the outcome would be, I'm not sure. They offered to ease some restrictions to allow us to put the bars on the windows. Because we're in a historic landmark building, then you can't just put bars up. And honestly, I don't like the way a business looks when it's barred behind the typical bars. So we came up with a solution to do artistic bars based on that phone call, because I already had it in work, something I had in my mind as just a kind of a fun project. And they gave us the go-ahead to do it. Of course, it was very expensive and time-consuming, and we just couldn't get it done before we got broken into again. Unfortunately, at that point, it was, do I spend the 10 grand on the bars, or do I spend the 10 grand moving to someplace else?
And what else did she say?
It was mainly just words of encouragement, you know, thanking us for being downtown and, you know, hoping that we could stick it out.
Did you tell her or mention to her that you're thinking about moving?
At that point, I really wasn't thinking about moving.
Okay.
That was after the third break in the spring, and they were back-to-back-to-back break-ins by apparently the same person. So they were just coming back over and over, and we couldn't, you know, slow things down fast
enough. Did you get a call from City Hall after you decided to move?
No.
You didn't?
No, I don't believe I did.
Wow, that's amazing. So were you surprised by the phone call?
This spring?
Yeah.
I kind of expected it because it was getting a lot of publicity. People were talking about it.
Yeah.
In the paper, in the news, over and over. It was just, and it was so rapid fire, you know. It was, I think, 3 times in 8 or 9 days we got hit. And it was just, yeah, it made news. So I was expecting something. And we got the calls of encouragement. A lot of community where it was very encouraging. So we did decide to stay after that third one in the spring.
Go ahead, caller. You've been patient.
Yes, good morning. I was hearing Mr. Johnson say, and I think we, you know, him and maybe other, business owners, they're trying to keep it alive downtown by bringing their business and everything. But, I have to say, I don't blame him for finally moving out because he was losing money, you know, and I think we just need more, it's nice to hear words of encouragement and everything, but we need more, maybe more security, more policemen down there or something, you know, or because these people that are just doing bad trouble here are just, they know that they got the upper hand and they can just do what they want and get away with it. But like Mr. Johnson, he's losing money, you know, and so I just feel we need more security, really, more officers down there. I know we probably can't afford that either, but this is discouraging because these people are trying to keep it alive like Mr. Johnson. So I wish Mr. Johnson well over there where he's at, and that was all I wanted to say this morning, and I'll keep listening to the show. Thank you, Mr. Mallow.
Okay, thank you for the call. Very encouraging phone call, and so we'll get some of your comments about what you think should happen downtown, your perception of downtown, and do you regret moving out? We'll get all those comments here in a little bit. We got to take a break here on Connect with Me on MeTV Fresno 436 MeTV Option 11. 436 MeTV Option 11 is the telephone number. Encourage you to call in today and give your opinion about downtown Fresno. And Mr. Darren Johnson here moving his business out. I mean, he didn't move it like to North Fresno or to Clovis. He went to Hanford. Why Hanford of all places? Well, we'll talk to him about that. McHenry Protective Services is your sponsor today here on the program.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com. All right.
Giddy up with Westerns. We've got the best ones. Superhero sci-fi Sven. Grab the popcorn and stay in. Drama's mystery and action. Take a look and see what happens. Carol, Andy, Lucy, MASH. Timeless comedies full of laughs.
Hey, that's me!
That's me.
That's me, Chief.
Yeah, me.
Me, 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 you gotta see. That's memorable. That's me.
Me,
TV.
Back here on the program with Darren Johnson, the man who had the guts to close down and move out of downtown Fresno because he'd had enough. And so we have a caller that has been patient, waiting through the commercial break here. Go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes. The problem downtown, the security that they need there, maybe we can hire a private security firm that, you know, bicycles, that can run some of the vagrants out of the area. There's a home, like an old elderly home, catty corner to the Chuck Chansey Park. And I'm thinking that, you know, there's people that are there. It's like some home manor or some, you know, for elderly. And they kind of bring their family or friends or whatever in that area. But, you know, bars on the windows, if there's something removable type bars that swing open so you can see inside the business. They did have collapsible kind of screens, big heavy screens in front of them. I think they still exist in
yeah.
the mall area.
Hey, caller, we're short on time here, so what's your question?
Okay.
Quickly.
The population in Hanford, is that enough for you for business as far as cycling? Are you advertising outside of Hanford or in the
area?
Yeah,
okay. Thank you. That's a good question.
Thank you.
So what do you think? Is Hanford going to be a big enough town to support your business?
Well, actually, Hanford has over 50,000 people, and Lemoore has over 25,000 people, I believe. But between Hanford, Lemoore, and the base, which are all very close, there's 80-plus thousand people. And no services for bike shops, which is why we're looking at it as a second location, because it's unheard of to have that big of a population base with no bike shop.
And so there's no bike shop in Hanford other than yours, and none in Lemoore?
And none in Lemoore either. Yeah, I actually probably have a bigger customer base out there than I do in Fresno when you consider the competition.
Is that right?
Yeah, and our geographic location downtown.
Okay, how long have you been in Hanford now? When did you set up shop there?
1 month ago. We'll be open 1 month tomorrow.
So it's been 1 month, and how's business been?
Honestly, it's about our best month ever. We've been
better than Fresno.
Better. It took 3 years to get to this point in Fresno, and I'm already right there. I've already hired part-time help, and I am behind on labor
so
quite a bit.
So tell us who's coming in, what services you're offering, and who's coming into your bike shop?
Everybody
for
from...
What? What are they coming in for? To buy a bike? To service a bike? What?
All of the above. Lots of just customers that haven't had service, that have been keeping...
Hang on, caller.
Keeping their bikes in storage, waiting for somebody, or having to drive to Fresno or Visalia, and just haven't bothered to do it. They're just bringing everything down
to
get
fixed. So people from Visalia are coming in.
Well, Hanford had to feed into Visalia for bikes, repairs, and that kind of thing before.
Because there are bike shops in Visalia.
Yeah. Yeah, the people in Hanford were having to go that far for service.
I see.
So a lot of people would just delay.
But are people in Visalia also going over there?
I've had a couple of customers. I don't really expect to cut into Visalia's market, at least their home market, or Fresno, but, you know, the people that were not wanting to make that trek to those towns.
And not only that, our show goes into Hanford, we go into Lemoore. I know that because we've had callers from there. So, you know, you're getting a lot of publicity, and you have gotten publicity in the B and other news outlets, and now this program here for an hour. So naturally, people are going to find out about you, hear about you, and say, oh, the guy's in Hanford now. It gives you free advertising and a way to really pump up more business.
Absolutely. But I'm just glad that it's positive.
Yeah.
In Fresno, pretty much it was all just negative. It was either negative input.
There's no such thing as negative publicity.
This is
okay,
true.
When you're a business owner, okay? Every word that's printed or said is publicity, period, right? For
absolutely.
You. And it could mean dollars in your pocket.
I guess it could. But it's nice to just be welcomed into the community and have that positive feel versus the
right.
To break in and
let's
that kind
go to the
thing.
Let's go to the caller. Caller, you're on the air with Darren Johnson. Go ahead.
Hi, Darren. You made a good choice as far as Hanford, but my question to you is, why didn't you go to the River Park area where there's maybe not even that much crime, whatever? And I think the mayor should have gone to your place to look over the areas that they can do as far as putting security. But my question to you is, why didn't you go into the River Park area with your business, and that you would have done a lot better there? That's my question to you.
Well, there's about 10 bike shops in Fresno already, and most of them are located River Park area and east and north. So moving into their territory probably wouldn't have been a great idea, especially if you include the very expensive rents in that area. So going out to Hanford, it keeps me isolated from that competition, and allows me to serve a community that doesn't have a bicycle shop option. You know, moving right into other bike shops' backyard isn't good business for anybody, really. So unfortunately, that's one of the reasons why we were downtown in the first place, is because we were geographically separated from the other bike shops, and we had an underserved customer base there. So when that didn't work out, you know, we thought, well, we'll go to another underserved customer base.
So you like being the big dog, the only dog in the area, no competition in Hanford, and serving Lemoore. So that serves you better with no competition.
Oh, absolutely. Especially being that we don't have the money to weather years of competing with other bike shops that have been established for decades.
Right.
It just makes it better for us to get a foothold and go in the right direction.
Okay, I want to roll a piece of videotape before we go to break here, and it's called Display Bikes. Let's roll that videotape. It says Display Bikes, and talk about some of the bikes that we're looking at here and some of the bikes that you have in your shop. This is video that was shot last week of your new bike shop in Hanford. Mm-hmm. And what are we looking at here?
There we're looking at Bianchi road bikes, you know, and then we're moving into hybrid style city bikes, mm-hmm. all from Bianchi in that row. Mm-hmm. Bianchi being the oldest bike brand in the world for 131 years and running so far. So we like them because they have the history and they have a nice product range. We've got a few fixed gears there, or track style bikes. More road bikes. Almost everything in this rack is Bianchi. That's our big brand as far as road going bikes go.
Yeah.
They have something to cover the whole spectrum, from an entry level bike to, you know, a high end road bike, really high end road bike. And here we're looking at public city bikes,
mm-hmm.
Dutch style city bikes, a company based out of San Francisco. We've been selling these since we opened our doors.
Mm-hmm.
Very popular bikes, great commuting bikes, great city bikes. Just for zipping around town, not having to get all kitted up in Lycra and do 50 miles.
Do you specialize in any particular bike? You mentioned Bianchi there being the oldest, but do you specialize, do you have custom-made bikes for women, for men?
We do have some custom-made options, higher-end. Italian steel bike options. We've also got working man's customs as well. But for the most part, we try to serve the whole spectrum.
Yeah.
I love putting commuters on bikes and people that want to actually use bikes as transport.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the high-end racing is always nice too. We've got a small race team that kill it every weekend they go out. So that's always fun to sell that kind of stuff too.
And the Olympics are coming up, and so I wonder if that's going to, and of course there's bike competition there. I wonder if there's going to be a spike in your business or an interest there because of the Olympics. Sometimes there is, sometimes there isn't, but what are your thoughts?
I would say not so much the Olympics, cycling typically doesn't get a lot of coverage in the Olympics, although there is some track cycling.
There is some coverage. There is
some road cycling.
Yeah, there's some road cycling, although maybe not in prime time anymore like it used to be, because with all the cable outlets and now the internet. So, you know, you have limited sporting events that you will see in prime time coverage, but you don't think it'll have that much of a spike or an interest in a boost in bike sales.
I don't. Not compared to, say, the Tour de France, which just ended.
Yeah, it did.
Those are always really good for bicycle sales and interest in general.
Okay, caller, you're on the air, and gotta cut you short here a little bit because we're short on time. But go ahead. What's your question?
I understand that we just talked about customizing bikes. There's an episode in the Shark Tank that's coming in 2017 that I have an invention for a bike. I don't know if you remember those little cars that when you were a kid, you rev up and then they take off. And what I did was I dissected that, and then I came up with a design that would modify on a bike that you could just pedal and pedal, and then you could just take off. You know, it's a really incredible invention. And have you ever thought of doing anything like that or come up with something similar to that?
Not me. I barely have enough time to keep the doors open. There's just not enough hours in the day. I would love to ride my bike every once in a while, and right now that's not even an option.
You're kidding. So you're open what time in the morning?
We open currently at 11.
And you
11
close?
To 6:30.
Oh.
When we're
considered
in Fresno.
Opening earlier?
In Fresno, we were open 10 to 7. Of course, one-man show, that was a pretty big stretch of hours, and of course there's the before hours and the after hours that go with that, so it makes for long days. But I, you know, moving to Hanford, we didn't know exactly what we were going to face, so we figured we'd start a little bit shorter on the hours and then expand them as needed. It's always easier to add hours than just to take them away.
Okay. So, hey, we're talking to Darren Johnson, and we're talking about his new bike shop that's over in Hanford. And I have to tell you, you know, you've you got this business owner that was broken into so many times in downtown Fresno, and the mayor's office, the administration, the city council, everybody's, you know, down there at downtown. They're touting up how great downtown is. It's safe. Come on downtown. What's there to do down there besides baseball? What businesses are there? Peeves Public House, is it closed still? It's still closed, right?
I believe it's still closed.
It's still closed. Okay. And so, you know, what is there to, and the other thing is, where are you going to park? Is it safe for your family to go after hours? For that matter, is it safe to go down there at noon, high noon? I don't know. So when this happens, you've got a guy, a business owner, who's taking a lot of risk and shows a lot of courage in putting his money where his mouth is. He just picked up and moved out. He cared more about his business than he did about the perception of downtown. 436 MeTV, option 11. Would you have done the same? Back in just a moment after this from McHenry Protective Services.
You can find movies on Over the Air Channel 13.3. Says it all.
It's no wonder why the city of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
Back here on the program talking about downtown Fresno and someone who had the courage to move out because of all the crime that's going on. And so I got a call, but before I do take that call, I've got to ask you something. Do the politicians have it wrong about downtown Fresno? They're touting it, building it up as if it's bigger than life itself. It's the greatest thing that's ever hit Fresno. They're opening up Fulton Mall. It's such a huge deal. There's so many things to do down there. You can go to a baseball game. You can go downtown and eat lunch. You can eat dinner. There's so many activities, and gee, there are all these housing units there. You've got Bitwise. Do they have it wrong?
I don't think they have it wrong. I just think that in my personal situation, I didn't have the resources to see it through. I think we're a little ways off.
It was wrong for you.
It was. I don't know if it was wrong for me. It allowed us to get to where we were before we started having a lot of trouble.
Well, apparently it was wrong for you. You moved out, for God's sake. You had all these break-ins, so it doesn't appear to me it was good for you.
Well, if you look at where we started with almost no inventory, almost nothing.
Yeah.
And we were able to build that from nothing to what it was. But
right. As
we got bigger and gained more exposure, including a massive storefront with a lot of expensive bikes inside,
yeah. We
became a target. And I didn't have the resources to keep going the way we were.
Should the mayor have done more to help you? Should the city of Fresno have done more to help you?
I honestly don't think it's their place as far as a public entity to help us.
Why not? To make it safe?
Well, to make it safe, yes.
I'm not talking about helping you financially. I'm talking about helping you keep the dang doors open.
Yeah.
Public safety should be number one. And it seems like it's been on the back burner with this mayor in office, slashing police, going head-to-head with the police union right off the bat when she got into office. So it seems like public safety maybe has not been at the forefront with this mayor. It's more building up this perception, perhaps false perception, about what's going on downtown. And is there a false perception?
That's kind of a tough question for me to answer. As far as safety, I think it's generally safe. But at night, like you said, everybody rolls up the sidewalks and goes home.
So
property crime, theft, that kind of thing, for me was pretty rough. I didn't ever feel unsafe being downtown, but I did feel like, you know,
did you feel safe 100% of the time?
When I was there, yes. When I wasn't there is when I worried.
Were you packing heat?
No. No.
You didn't have a gun under the counter?
No.
Okay. All right. Caller, you've been patient. Go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes. I think the gentleman, what happened with Fresno was they did everything in reverse. They should have solidified downtown first and then brought in amenities like the stadium and other things like that, and there would be just a different feel. If you look at what Old Town Clovis did with their things, they made that decision 50 years ago to start improving their downtown. So it's basically like a walking mall is what it is. Same thing with downtown Visalia.
Yeah.
I'm sure downtown Hanford looks way different from what Fresno does.
Right.
So they actually could have done it because most of the walking malls in the country are now shut down. There's only three left now.
I know.
With Fresno going out, there's only going to be two. But they should have done this 30, 40 years ago.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask the gentleman, do you think someday you'll ever go back to Fresno if they improve downtown enough? Or would you rather do something more like having like a little satellite place like in Lemoore, where you could have a small shop where they would just do repairs and ordering parts and maybe having them installed there rather than opening a full shop or going back to Fresno?
Yeah, good question.
That was it. Thank you.
And actually, both of those were considerations and still are.
So after Fulton Street opens up, you will consider having like a little satellite store in downtown Fresno. You'll consider that?
Actually, we were looking as soon as we solidified Hanford. We were looking back in Fresno. I don't think I've got the resources to make it happen at the moment.
Right.
But I do feel like we've created a customer base that we are leaving behind that needs service. So, we've actually considered something very small and very secure as far as a satellite location downtown Fresno.
Okay, let's roll another piece of videotape. It's called Bike Seats. And I have a big question for you. Looking at bike seats, and that is with some of the older people, the older generation, they're looking to ride a bike for exercise, to get, you know, to get the blood flowing through the arteries, through the veins, whatever the case may be, get their heart pumping, get their blood pressure up a little bit, and get those legs pumping. But it's difficult when you're, you know, over the age of 40 or 50 or even 60, in some cases, to find a comfortable seat. These seats don't look comfortable to me. They're for 20-year-olds, 25-year-olds, 30-year-olds. They're not for 60-year-olds, right?
Not necessarily. Most of it has to do with your seated position on the bike.
Really?
If you're sitting very upright, narrow saddle like the first ones we were looking at would be murder. But the saddles you're looking at there are actually very comfortable for people. It takes some breaking in. They're very thick, heavy leather, but they're the kind of saddle that would last decades with proper care.
And so you're telling me that those seats I'm looking at right there are comfortable?
On the right bike, yes. And if you're in the right position on that bike, yes.
Does it depend on the person's weight? If they weigh 300 pounds, how comfortable is that seat going to be as compared to someone who's 130 or maybe 165 pounds?
Same thing. It's more of a matter or a function of the positioning on the bike. If you're sitting on a beach cruiser and you're sitting straight up and down, upright, you need a wider saddle. If you're on a racing bike and you're further forward in your position, you need a much narrower saddle because it's a saddle. You're straddling it the more forward you're tilted.
Yeah, so. See, I'm not looking to race, okay? Mm-hmm. I mean, I did that years ago. I tried to race bikes, and I thought I was really fast, weaving in and out of traffic. And all that. I don't do that. If I want a bike, I want a bike so I can use it for exercise. So I want a seat that's wider, that's more comfortable, that's flatter. Are those seats available?
Oh, absolutely. But the same thing goes, I wouldn't put that on your high-performance road bike. You still, if
you're
not
looking to buy a high performance road bike for me, but that's for the younger people.
Not necessarily. I've got, but it does depend on your position on the bike. And that's what it boils down to. It boils down to getting the right saddle for the bike and your position on the bike.
Right.
Whether or not it's wide or narrow.
Want to roll another piece of videotape? It's called accessories. There are a lot of accessories that come with the bike. And, you know, if you're carrying a little bit of cash, like $20 or $30, you have to have some place to put it. Do you have any accessories like that? We're looking at some accessories here. What are we looking at, by the way?
Oh, we're looking at various bike racks for the back and seat bags and baskets. Most of this stuff is, and then we've got some
What's that?
Handlebar tape of all different sorts. I've got more handlebar tape than you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things for freshening up your bike to make it feel new after a big tune-up. Or just you want to add a new splash of color, something like that. You want to change the colors of the saddle and the tape, seat bags. You know, some of these are born out of necessity. You've got to carry, you know, repair equipment, spare tubes.
So you do have patches. Seat bags. You can you can put your money in. You can put your keys in. You might even be able to put a water bottle in there, depending on how big it is, or other little tiny accessories. Those are probably pretty popular accessories, I would imagine.
Yeah, pretty much everybody with a road bike has got some kind of a bag. Or they're stuffing a lot of stuff in their pockets, which is sometimes how I roll too. So you never know. Yeah.
Who's your customer base that comes in and buys these bikes, the accessories? Is it the young, the old, the in-between?
Boy, it's been the whole range in Hanford. In downtown Fresno, it's probably more younger crowd.
There's a basket. You can put a basket on your bike. Go shopping, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Go to the grocery store.
Yeah, some of those were removable baskets that you could actually take in the store with you.
Yeah. Those are some of the water bottles and some of the DVDs, I guess you can look at, take them home. Darren Johnson is here. A lot more video to show you before the show ends here. 436 MeTV, option 11. Darren Johnson had the courage to move out of downtown Fresno. 436 MeTV, option 11. McHenry Protective Services is your sponsor today. Back in just a moment.
It's no wonder why the city of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
Take a look at this.
Let's play.
This is too hip for you. I'll slow down.
Let's play.
Watch all your favorite classic game shows on Buzzer TV, KVBC Digital Channel 13.7.
Back here with Darren Johnson, I want to roll another piece of videotape as you prepare to call in, 436-ME-TV, option 11. It's called Kids Bikes. Popular with a lot of families?
Oh, yeah.
They come in and buy bikes for their kids?
Yeah, yeah.
Of all ages?
Of all ages. Downtown Fresno, we didn't have a lot of kids bike customers. Mainly
are
because
these kids
we didn't,
bikes?
Those are mainly adult bikes, but some of those ranged in size down to about 4'8". So.
Oh wow.
Yeah, you could you can fit
like
your 10-year-old.
I don't know if we have. Is this the right video here? Or it is kids bikes. Okay, kids bikes may be coming up here, and so you're looking at a certain segment, a market to market these kids bikes, and there they are right there. You got tricycles, right?
Actually, I don't have any tricycles. I've got
those are training wheels.
There's some training wheels on a couple of them, and in even the really tiny balance bikes, they call them bikes with no pedals for children as young as even before 2 years of age. My son's been on one now since he was 16 months, and he loves that thing. He zips that little red one right there. He zips all over the store, and he doesn't want to ride his own bike when he gets to the shop. He wants to ride that one.
Two and a half, okay.
And he's got the balance down, yeah.
Right. And so what are you looking for when you're looking for a kid's bike? Are you looking, does the make and model not make any difference at this point? What does make a difference when you're 2, 3, 4, 5 years old?
What makes the difference is the assembly of the bicycle, the weight of the bicycle, the proper balance of the bike, things that are very important, especially for a child. You want them to be interested in the bike. You don't want them to say, oh, this is too hard to ride, and put it down. So actually, I think it's more important sometimes for a child to have a good quality bike versus the big box type of a bike, so that they get that interest and they keep it, because it is a lot easier to ride a properly put together bike.
All right, let's talk about some of the parts that accessories, or actually parts that you can buy aside from buying the bike itself. Let's roll that videotape, and you can talk about the various parts that we're looking at here up on the screen as we take the videotape full screen there. What are we looking at in terms of various parts, bicycle parts?
Here we're seeing a bunch of cogs and replacement chains. You know, bikes require pretty regular service, and things like a chain is a serviceable part that you would change on a regular basis.
Change out the chain, really?
Oh yeah.
How often should you do that?
It's a mileage and wear thing and conditions thing. Most people go thousands of miles before changing a chain, but you know, it could be something like on a cyclocross bike where you're doing it once a season just because of the conditions that you're riding it in. And some people just want to change it so they can get the cool colors like that one there. Mm-hmm. Just to add a little splash of color to a bike where you wouldn't necessarily expect it.
Yeah. And so what do these parts cost? What does it cost to, say, change out a chain?
Oh, a chain can be as little as about $8 to as much as $150.
To change it out?
Well, that's just for the parts. I usually charge like $5 to put a chain on. But chains vary wildly in price.
Yeah. And some of the other parts that we're looking at here are?
Still chains.
There are a lot of different styles to the chains, right?
A lot of different styles. It depends on if it's a one-speed bike or a multi-speed bike and how many gears you're actually running. Here we've got some cogs for the rear, for the back wheel. That's also another wear part. Sometimes people just like to change those to change the gear ratio of their bike for climbing or high-end speed. It depends on the person, what they need. We've got some front chain rings there, mainly just to add a splash of color or to change your gear ratio.
Yeah. Hey, I've got to ask you, getting back to your business, how many employees do you have now that you moved to Hanford?
I have one.
Which
is huge for me. For the past 3 years, I've been running by myself.
Right. You mentioned that, but you have just one employee now. Yeah, I thought it sounded like maybe you had hired an employee or two or three. But you've got one in the shop now.
Mm-hmm.
How big a difference is that making to you?
Huge. Just to catch up with all the little things, you know, putting orders away, making those phone calls, catching up on the backlog of repair bikes that are coming in. And we do plan to add at least another. So,
and you never would have been able to hire that one employee had you stayed in Fresno?
It didn't look like it. The numbers just weren't quite there. It was, I think it was probably getting close, but we just didn't quite make it as far as getting to the point of being able to hire an employee.
What about Craig Chardon? He's the owner of Peeves Public House, and he has a clothes shop. Have you spoken to him? And if so, what have you spoken to him about?
I haven't spoken to him since he closed. I don't know what the plan is there. So I wouldn't even want to begin to comment on what's going on there. If it's reopening and in what capacity, I don't know.
What did he say to you the last time you talked to him?
Well, he's always very encouraging. He's a definitely downtown advocate. Can't blame him. I was a downtown
advocate.
Even now,
you think he is? Even now?
I'm sure he is. And I still believe that downtown's going the right way. I just couldn't stomach the losses anymore myself. I just couldn't do it.
You think downtown's going the right way? In what direction?
In the direction that it should, as far as
be specific.
Commerce.
Okay.
And getting the traffic moving around. The Fulton Mall was just, it was rough to be there and see nobody using it, and the people that were using it maybe a little bit less desirable than they should have been. So just adding the street and traffic and movement to downtown, physical, actual movement of cars and people, I think circulation.
So you're in favor of opening up the Fulton Street?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay.
Something needed to change.
I do. Got to go to a quick break. 436 MeTV Option 11, back after this from McHenry Protective Services.
Is taking care of laundry taking too much of your time? Have you become a missing mom? With a new, fast, efficient washer and dryer from Ventura TV Video Appliance, you'll spend more of your day the way you want. Save now on Frigidaire's Advanced Affinity Laundry Pair. Let Frigidaire save you energy, water, and time. Don't spend your life on laundry. Upgrade today at Ventura TV Video Appliance and save.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
Darren Johnson is the owner of the Fulton Cycle Works, and he is located now in Hanford on what street?
We're on Irwin Street, 8th and Irwin, right near the park downtown.
All right, and so let's roll another piece of videotape called Repairs. Do you do a lot of repairs on some of the bikes that come in?
A lot of repairs.
Hmm.
I could probably stay busy all day long doing nothing but repairs.
Are these some of the tools that you use for those repairs?
Yes. Yeah, that's some of the tools. Yeah, the basic hand tools, I guess you'd say.
Yeah. What do people come in for usually?
Oh boy, everything from a flat repair to a full rebuild of a bike, reconditioning. We've done complete restorations minus the actual paintwork.
Anybody ever come in with a bent frame?
Yes.
They have.
Yes, and then we just say, you need a new bike.
You can't fix that, right?
You can, but most of the time, unless it's a very expensive frame, you know, worth saving, it's just doesn't pencil out money-wise.
All right, we got a piece of videotape for those people that have nothing but money to spend, my friends. Those people that are spendthrifts, that want the most expensive bike on the market. Let's roll the videotape, and you can talk about, Darren, what we're looking at on the screen at home. What is this?
Aha. That is a Torelli Nitro Express. Mm-hmm. It's a custom build. Those are actually handmade in Italy, the frame set, and then they're shipped to the States raw with no paint, and then they're painted here in California, and then we'll build them from there. This one happens to be my personal bike.
It is?
It is.
What'd you pay for that baby?
I have no idea.
Oh, come
I can't, on. I can't say that on TV.
Yeah, you can.
My wife might hear it.
No, I want to know how much this bike costs.
Well, if you were to buy this bike, it would probably cost you about $7,000.
Yeah.
As far as the bike world goes, that's a little scuff on the saddle there. That's about half of what I could sell you a bike for. I could sell you a brand new Bianchi out of the box that's not custom built for about $14,000. We don't typically keep something like that in stock because usually that customer knows exactly what they're looking for and is willing to wait one day or 2 days to get it in the shop to order
it. Wow. Usually pay with a credit card or do they write a check?
Honestly, I've never sold a $14,000 bike.
Oh, you haven't?
But
what's the most expensive you've sold?
Probably in that $5,000 or $6,000 range.
Yeah.
And hopefully that may change a little bit in the new shop. We'll see.
And you, this is your bike here. What do you need with a bike like this?
I mean, as far as the components that are on there, you build it how you would want to ride it.
Yeah.
Everything is hand-picked as far as the handlebar width and tire size, the tire type. The wheels were custom built. Everything is very, very lightweight. Most of the time when you start spending money like this, you're doing it to save grams or you're doing it to keep a bike, you know, its provenance intact.
Did you buy it for the investment because you might want to resell it?
Actually, I bought this as a way to display one in the store.
Okay.
It's easier because these are custom built frames that without being able to see a complete built bike, people have no idea what it's going to look like and what it can be. So you build a bike.
You ever sold a bike like this to a customer?
Yeah. Yeah, we've done several customs.
Really?
Yeah.
No, but that specific one, have you sold the Italian bike?
Lots of Italian bikes, but not the Torelli. The Torelli is new to us.
You've never sold a Torelli to anybody?
No. No. But we've only had them for a few months.
Is that a racing bike? Is that what that is?
It's a racing bike, yeah. But it's also a very comfortable steel. It's just a high-performance road bike. You don't have to be a racer to buy a bike like that.
Okay, I'm going to ask you some tough political questions now that you're here.
Because oh, boy.
You know what? You created this mess. I mean, you picked up and moved out. So I have to put you on the spot a little bit. No, I appreciate your time. Thank you for coming in. By the way, what's your phone number before we run out of time?
It's 559-917-3678.
Yeah. By the way, you didn't create this mess. It was the burglars that created the mess, and you just had the courage to move out, and I really commend you for that. Didn't want to stick around and tolerate that kind of behavior anymore. You were losing money. And as a business owner, people out there should know it takes a long time to build up a business. You put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into it. You also put a lot of money into it, hoping that you can, within 5 years, you can build that business to a sustainable level. And if you can't do that, then a lot of businesses, they just go by the wayside. So you decided to take the bull by the horns. So congratulations on that. But who's more fit to be mayor to take care of this problem, Perea or Brand? In your opinion, who's more of a law and order guy? Got 1 minute.
I got to go with Brand.
He's the law and order guy?
I believe he'd be more the law and order guy, yes.
Because?
I honestly don't get too much into the politics. I really don't. But
did either Perea or Brand reach out to you?
Actually, I had Perea come into the shop. And his son was a customer of mine.
Okay.
And I sold a bike to him and his wife and his daughter.
Okay.
And I did have
senior come in
and talk to me one day. But I don't even remember between what series of break-ins that was. But
he was concerned.
He was concerned, yes.
That you were going to move out. Yeah.
Potentially. Okay. Yeah.
Listen, Darren, I commend you. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. It's
all
good
right.
to be here.
All
I appreciate right. you having me.
So, Darren Johnson, our guest today, that is Fulton Cycle Works in the city of Hanford. And your phone number, one more time, is?
917-3678.
All right, 917-3678. If you want a new bike, back tomorrow with Peter Nazaridian. See you then. Have a good day.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
If you have a need to promote your business or event, please consider MeTV Fresno for your next campaign. MeTV reaches over 100,000 of your potential customers in the Fresno area every single week. Plus, you can...